A very good evening to all of you. Thank you for coming for our monthly lecture in June. It would be amiss if I do not start with directing all our attention to a great loss that the urban sector has actually experienced over the last few weeks. We've actually lost three extremely important figures in the story of urbanization and the urban sector in our country, starting with Dr. K.C. Sivaramakrishnan, who passed away having been ailing from cancer for almost close to about a year after it was detected, after which we lost Dr. M.N. Butch, Mahesh Butch, who has been a director of the National National Institute of Urban Affairs before, in the past, and again a towering figure in the urban sector, one of the members of the National Commission on Urbanization, and a key moving figure in a lot of the discourse that was developed in the 80s on the urban sector. And most recently, we have lost Charles Correa, whose book I never tire of referring to, The New Landscape, which actually changed. It was for us a new paradigm of thinking about cities. In fact, it made us think about cities when we were students in the School of Planning and Architecture. So it is truly a brutal last few weeks. I think for all those who either had worked with or interacted with these three towering figures, or at least cherished the writings and other interactions that they left with us as memories. So before I actually commence the evening, if I may request all of us to please rise and maintain a minute's silence in the memory of these three individuals. Thank you. Thank you. I'm too young to have actually interacted with Mahesh Butch very much, but I had the occasion, and in fact, the first and only real interaction I had with him was when he came to deliver the first lecture of 2015 in this very same series of lectures. And what he left to me as a gift was the fact that he shared the thought that he had done what he had to do during his generation, and he wanted that us, who were younger and a little more confused than them, should find the anchor and should find the faith to champion the cause of a more balanced, a more rational, a more sensible form of urbanization for this country. It's a wonderful way to remember someone, because he reinforced, I think, the thought of what gurus and teachers are. I think are the reason why we respect them very much. And I think that would be the most appropriate entry point for me to introduce today's speaker, who has been my teacher as well, and also ushered me into teaching when I started as a very young boy in SPA, wanting to teach after having been a student there. And Professor K.T. Ravindran gave me the opportunity to come to his Department of Urban Design in SPA, and one of the first classes I taught in SPA was in that department. Professor Ravindran has been a mentor, a friend, a guide, a teacher to many generations of students, not only at the School of Planning and Architecture in Delhi, but also as one who has, I think, been an itinerant guru. I believe you've used that term yourself, Katie, an itinerant guru around the country, has inspired students and architects and planners and urban designers throughout the country. And so we are truly very honored that K.T. Ravindran has agreed to deliver this lecture today. And also another guru who has chosen to move from Ahmedabad to Delhi, which for which we are of course grateful, Dr. Shravan Acharya, who has moved to the Jawaharlal Nehru University from the SEPT University. Or was it SEPT University when you left? Or
yeah.
Okay, from the SEPT University in Ahmedabad, and we are of course the better for that. And so we have, I think, a wonderful combination of two thinkers and two gurus and two perspectives on the urban sector in India for this evening. I'm not going to go into lengthy introductions beyond this, but I thank both of you for coming today and look forward to a very lively discussion. So with that, I'd like to invite Professor K.T. Ravindran.
Thank you, Jagan. After that very somber introduction to the evening, with having lost three most important people in our field, I thank Jagan for asking me to be here today, and also the NIUA for having hosted this. And thank you, Dr. Acharya, for agreeing to be here. Actually, Acharya means a guru. My name doesn't mean that. So basically, what I plan to do is to project seven critical moves which are made by the government in recent times, which will actually finally impact the city in India and will help reshape the cities as they are envisaged. Now, there's been a really big flurry of schemes which have been brought out, apparently sourced from different locations in the government and announced separately with different time frames and different financial frames. And what I'd like to do is to look at how these multiple moves will finally converge on the urban local body. And we need to look at the capacity of the urban local body to actually handle this this huge set of funds and urban changes and forces that will influence the reshaping of their own environment. Now, it is also necessary for them to look at how their already existing responsibilities under the 74th Amendment is actually, will it help them to assimilate these, or would these mean additional work for them? Additional work in the sense that additional skills, additional time frames, additional reorganization of administrative structures, all those changes will have to be made at the local level. Finally, if the schemes have to benefit the people on the street or the people who live, ordinary people who live in our cities, then what is it that the local body needs to do, and how these projects which are being brought out from the center, how will they finally play itself out at the local level to benefit the people? Now, that is the whole trajectory which I'd like to trace. So the way I've structured the presentation is that first, since this is an open forum, I've given a little usual data on what urbanization, the dimensions of urbanizations are in current India. And then after that, I look at one by one all the seven issues. And how much time do I have altogether? Okay. I have about 30-odd slides, all of them packed with information. So obviously, I won't be going into too much of detail of each of those things. Some of it you can read. And I'll be happy to share if anybody wants to take them away to read them, so that I don't have to go into details of each sheet. Because all these seven projects have got reams and reams of paper that's been generated by the government, by various organizations in the government. some of them spearheaded by NIUA and Jagan, because the government also habitually parks all these schemes in NIUA. And it's like carrying coal to Newcastle to come to NIUA to speak about these projects. But however, I'm venturing on it with the idea that we can look at how the salient factors of these projects will finally play out at the local level. And I will, at the end of it, I have 2 pages of what I've called the way ahead as to what needs to be done if this connect between this huge sets of funds and the people on the streets have to be made. How does one make sure that it actually plays out in a way that benefits people? We have had the experience of JNURM, in which we know that for various reasons, JNURM has been only partially successful. Different levels of success is claimed by different quarters in the government and outside the government. But in reality, how has it transformed the Indian city is anybody's guess. Or we all know how it has done so little to visibly change the Indian city. Sorry, how does one change this? Oh, yes, okay. So I first want to give you a little detail of, since this is a general forum, that I've given you these details, but I find that most people in this hall are already converted, all people who know all these figures or have heard them or read them many times over, so I won't go into too much of detail of this. But in general, there is a problem that is facing, there's a crisis that's facing the Indian urban scenario. And if that crisis needs to be met, we need to look at an immediate actualization of a new national urbanization report. The last one was in 1988. It was chaired by Charles Correa, who just died. And the most active member in that group was M.N. Birch, who also just died. So now the field is clear for Jagan to spearhead the next set of reforms in the urban agenda through the formulation of a new policy for urbanization. These are the 7 issues that I've isolated. They are all, some of them are acronyms of long things. The others are descriptive in their content. But one of the things that you will find is actually an odd thing out in this is the 74th Amendment, which actually is not a policy document, but it is a real change that's been brought out into the Constitution. Almost 2 decades ago, but nothing much has happened on it. A little bit has happened on it. But if you look at how it impacts the urban local body, it has a massive impact on the urban local body. That's the reason why it is here, even though it is not really part of any project. The 74th Amendment actually defines a totally new role for the urban local body. And on top of it, whatever we do now also has to be within the framework of the 74th Amendment because it's a constitutional change and the change is still in place. Till the 74th Amendment gets amended further, the whatever schemes that we actually put on ground will have to be faced by through these 74th Amendment. And incidentally, the architect of the 74th Amendment was Mr. Sivaramakrishnan, who also just died. So this is why what Jagan said was so critical, that the 3 people who have been the most influential people in the field of urban development has just left us, and now the field is like open for all of us who are sitting in this room to take forward. Many of them had been looking back at what has happened, and Sivaramakrishnan, for instance, was quite critical of many aspects of the 74th Amendment, because he had the intellectual honesty to accept changes which has come into the field of urbanization and see the mismatches that 74th Amendment had with them. And he had the intellectual honesty to accept that that change has not been positive, even from the perspective of the 74th Amendment. But for us, it's critical because my final focus is the urban local body. Because all said and done, who are going to deliver these? Who is going to be the final handholder of the people on the street? That's going to be the urban local body. They are the elected people, and with whom even the master planning exercise is vested in the 74th Amendment. Not that all of us have practiced it. There's been very little of that practice. But however, on paper, it is still with the urban local body as far as the 74th Amendment is concerned. What I'll do is I have 3-4 slides on each of these heads, and I'll quickly go through them. I won't go into reading them out or describing them in detail, but however, I'll just give you a flair of what these missions are and how many crores have been committed by the government within what time period for these projects. So altogether about 1 lakh crore is under the new urban missions over the next 5 years from the center itself. Now this money has to be matched by local investment, either by the local body, the state governments, or by the private partners who will be taking a critical role in bringing out these projects in real terms. So 50% of the project cost for the cities up to 10 lakh population, and 33% of the project cost for those above 10 lakh population. This is how the government has divided the money. I'll be happy to share these figures with you later. They're all on the ministry's website. Nothing is invented. I've just culled out specific things with the help of a few researchers who are working with me. The essentials which would actually finally impact the implementation on the ground. Now, the two missions are also seen as interlinked. That is the Smart Cities mission, which is going to be now announced on the 25th of this month. There's a big 2-day do in the Vigyan Bhavan. I'm sure many of you who are in this hall must be invited to those places. In the Vigyan Bhavan to the launch of both these two missions. And the Amrit scheme actually adopts a project approach, not a master plan approach, to ensure basic infrastructure services relating to water supply, sewerage, waste management, etc., etc. Now, if you look at what the JNNURM wanted to do, that's not very different from this. Basically, it's a repackaging of similar issues because the packaging was not incorrect in the case of JNNURM. How it played out on the ground is what went wrong, mainly because the local bodies did not have the capacity to handle those issues which are thrown up at them, which still has not changed as a situation. Now there is more details here of how these projects are envisaged. So they are talking about incentive-based reforms. They will not appraise individual projects at the center, like JNNURM used to not only appraise the individual projects, they also monitored how the money has been spent periodically, and there was considerable amount of centralized control. Now, one of the first sources of this conflict is that in India, urban development is a state subject and not a central subject. So however much the center might want to wish changes happening in the cities, however much they might want to drive the engine of economic growth, it's the state government which is sitting on the driver's seat. So depending on the way the center-state relationships play out, the schemes and their implementation also play out. Now, there's one more layer in which that conflict is still vested. That is the conflict between the state government and the local body, particularly because sometimes the local body, which is through a separate electoral process is with an opposition party, and the state government doesn't want them to perform. Or sometimes the state government is in an opposite party and the center doesn't want it to perform. So there are all kinds of political interests and conflicts that play out. There are also local politics, because a lot of the 74th Amendment insists on elected representatives being part of the master plan process and its implementation process. And very often, the conflict that arises between different elected members also play out as conflicts on the implementation. So there are multiple levels at which there are political conflict which inform the whole implementation process. Now, we have seen that the fragmented and project-based approach will not work, as has been the experience in JNNURM. Proper planning and holistic approach based on citizen engagement will be necessary. Now, this is not to say that the JNNURM did not have citizens' engagement. Citizens' engagement was centrally vested also in the JNNURM. If you read the fine print, it is necessary for them to, in fact, use the 74th Amendment. But since all the local bodies were eager to get money, because they saw that this money is coming free from somewhere above there, they didn't worry about whose money it is. So they were eager to get the money, and therefore they made out projects. I mean, they approached consultants, they got projects done, they got them appraised, and they moved their political and bureaucratic contacts and made sure that some money came into each of these. But most of them have not been able to spend that money. And they have now been given an ultimatum by this government to spend the money or return it. So there is a scheme that is worked out within this, in which they want to help the money or the projects which are half done to be completed by help from the center. So it is a kind of a continuation of the JNNURM in some way that one is seeing. Now, whether this money is the money that will be given to complete those projects will be outside this Amrit project or not is not very clear. It's possible that it will be within that, because the experience of JNNURM has been that they have not been able to expend the money. So as a result, they had to one by one dilute the conditionalities which are placed in the 74th Amendment, in the JNNURM document, saying that you must have this kind of accounting, you must have this participation, you must have this, you must have that, you must charge money for the services. All of them were diluted one by one, because if they insisted on it, they wouldn't be able to spend the money. So if the government doesn't spend the money, it'll get into trouble from the sources from where the money came. Some of it has come from our pocket, it's the taxpayers' money, but there are also other sources, banks, etc., who fund these projects. So there was a kind of a contingency situation where the whole urban scenario was flooded with cash, but not the capacity to utilize it. So this is one of the reasons why JNNURM did not really go down to ground level benefit. In many cases, if you look at a lot of projects which are done in water supply or augmentation or construction of roads, Delhi got many flyovers through JNNURM. Delhi got Connaught Place restored and whitewashed through JNNURM. We have had many projects like that all across the country which were done. But Delhi particularly, many of them got done through the... They mixed the Commonwealth Games and the JNNURM, and they mixed and matched... they converged all the... they made them co-terminus in many cases and tried to push projects at that time. And a lot of money got spent in Delhi. But how well spent, we don't know, because many of those projects have now ended up in court cases. So, and all the engineers who worked on them have gone back to their villages because they don't want to show up in Delhi anymore. But they are in serious trouble if they show up here. So, the long and short of it is that there were very serious gaps in the way the implementation process was designed. And that is the gap that we need to look at when we look at the new scenario. Now, the reforms that Amrit scheme asked for are these eight. One is e-governance, which was there as part of JNNURM, constitution of professional municipal cadre, which was not there in JNNURM, but it is a very essential requirement to do so. Now it is realized that it's absolutely necessary to professionalize the municipal cadre. Very often, leave alone the municipal cadre, if you look at the planning bodies, for instance, when I went on some work to Pune to look at how the Chetan was with me on that project, when we went for meetings with the planner, local planner, who was also present, he was a diploma holder in engineering. He was not a planner. And he was the planner in charge of the Pune district, which is a thriving, throbbing urban center, and under which we also had the Lavasa project. So it was this man who could not even speak properly in front of an official because he was scared of the official. He was the chief planner of the district. This is the level at which we have the local cadres. I'm just giving an example. Very often, many of the municipalities, even in the most literate states, are unable to fill a form when they have to apply for a loan. They don't know how to fill the form. They need a consultant to come and help them to fill the form so that they can apply for a loan. So that is the level of expertise we have at local bodies as far as technical capabilities are concerned. So this constitution of a professional municipal cadre is a very critical requirement. I'll go through very quickly because each one of them can take a lot of time. So devolving funds on functions to urban local bodies, which is also fraught with a lot of complications because it has to first go to the state and the state has to divert it to the local body. And that whole process, there are lots of negotiations and checks and balances, and the local body initially loses out on that bargain. Then there is the review of building bylaws, which not many or most of the local bodies in India are not capable of. Then you have improvement and assessment of collection of municipal taxes, which we know in this country is in a dismal condition. Places like Delhi have now introduced better reforms, and it's very easily possible to reform the tax regime at the local level. But the effort and the expertise has to be given to those places for it to happen. Now, credit rating of urban local bodies, it's an impossible thing to do, any credit rating of our, because they don't have money to pay salaries. What kind of credit rating are you going to get when you're not able to pay salaries for 2 months, 3 months, 4 months to your own employees? So, but this is one of the requirements in it. And they're asking for an energy and water audit, all tall order, but it needs to be done. Then they need to have citizen-centric urban planning. Now, if you take the case of Delhi itself, you talk about citizen-centric urban planning, we have a plan which is taken back to the people as participation after it has been legally approved as a zonal plan. So the zonal plan is taken and shown to the people and said, this is the plan you're going to get. And that's called participation. Yeah. So, in real terms, we need to put planning on its head and formulate the plan by participatory process. But if you ask the local body to do it, they're not going to be in that position to do it. In many cases, they still have the planning hierarchy, starting with the state chief planner to district planners and so on, in many states, and most of them are not vested with the municipal body as mandated in the 74th Amendment. There are some places, for instance, in Kerala, it is vested, and they detest the idea of working under whom they call semi-literate politicians, because the chief planner has to work under the mayor, who is an elected rep. So it's a very uncomfortable equation. Leave alone the planning hierarchy, the bureaucratic hierarchy is also very uncomfortable working with elected reps, because they are now the new bosses in the 74th Amendment. That's why it is really not got into real implementation in many parts of the country, but in some parts it has already happened. Now, for the JNNURM projects, which are sanctioned in between 2005 and 2012, it had a 7-year period where they could not spend much of the money. Those which have achieved physical progress of 50%, availing 50% of central assistance released, and those which are sanctioned between 12 and 14 will be supported till March of 2017 to complete their projects. Now, is just financial support sufficient? Is that the reason why they couldn't deliver? Obviously, it is not. Everybody is flushed with funds, but they're not able to spend it because they don't have the technical capacity to spend that money intelligently at the local level. So we have 102 projects with physical progress of 50% in the JNURM framework, and we have 296 projects sanctioned during 2012-14, which also qualify with this 50%. So the parameters for central assistance are vested with these kind of 50% accomplished projects and more. But in another 2 years, if they were to do what they could not achieve in the last 10 years, that looks like an impossibility. So one can as well write this off as a venture. Now I come to the issue of the smart city. I'll move quicker than this because I think I'm laboring over things too much. This is just a diagram to show what a smart city is. Basically aiming at a higher quality of life. Most critical component is good participatory governance. Any which way, without a good participatory governance, it is not possible to have what you call a smart city. It's no more smart if it's not participatory, and it's what we call good governance. That is, there is proper delivery of the urban services and all other amenities which the municipality is bound to deliver. Work, mobility infrastructure is critical, and housing and social infrastructure is also critical. But the essential instruments prescribed in the Smart City paper are these. First is energy security, food security, water security, demand management, optimizing human resources, private sector participation, citizens' participation, and improved access to information and smart governance. These are the wish list of how a city should function. And as far as financing the smart city is concerned, there is a per capita investment cost envisaged at 43,386 rupees per head for over the next 20-year period. Estimates cover water supply, sewerage, sanitation, etc., etc. This is per capita expenditure that they plan will happen in a smart city. But somehow, when you talk about these urban services, the paper is silent on the nervous system of the smart city, which is the critical part of being smart, is that you have a smart nervous system within the city, which is responsive, which is quick to assess problems, which is quick to provide solutions, which is quick to access amenities, which is quick where in the citizens' participation with the governance process is concerned. Now, using an average figure of 1 million people in each of the 100 smart cities, the total investment required for services is 7 lakh crores over the next 20 years. This is the estimated amount of money. So it's a huge sum of money which is going to be spent within the next 7 years on these. And where is the capacity to absorb this money? How are we going to actually projectize these expenditure patterns? That is the area which is still needs to be worked out. Now, it's believed that by private participation and effective governance, that is, if you have a smart participant from the outside, you need a smart system within the government who, like, they have to be like two equal partners who can handle the issues with equal deftness. That is the assumption on which this kind of a participation can work, either private participants. Now, the whole amount translates to about 35,000 crores as the requirement only for these 100 smart cities. Now, within this, there is also the provision for smartening up the existing cities, for which a competition has been floated. What is the result of that competition, Jagan, between cities to apply for smart funds? Has anything played itself out as yet?
No, not yet.
The Bloomberg Foundation thing?
It's going to be a smart cities challenge for selection of the smart cities.
It hasn't started yet. After the launch,
then it will start.
So there is an application which the city has to make based on certain criteria to avail the funds on to improve its so-called smart infrastructure. And many of the cities which are already smart will be able to get smarter. But those who are not smart will not be able to apply. That's what it means. So as we know, it's the good student who always gets the scholarship. So it's the good city which is going to get the money. That's going to be the pattern if this is the criteria used. But of the central funds, roughly about 60% will be investment in infrastructure and 10% for e-governance initiatives. It is expected that e-governance will be largely private agency driven and that infrastructure will be largely provided by the government. Unless basic infrastructure is there, the land values remain low, the profitability of the projects remain low, and therefore investment attraction will also remain low. So it is very critical that in the initial stages itself, infrastructure is pumped up and money is poured into infrastructure, which can then translate into real value in terms of what the local body can encash for developing a proper smart environment. An additional 5,000 crores are required to prepare reference frameworks, that is, making DPRs, etc. It's not bad money for making DPRs, it's good money. So I think most of us who are in this hall are in good business, because this money will be up for the take. Of course, it will need to be based on performance of what we do professionally, but this is the provision that's made within the plan. And the infrastructure as complete private investments or through PPPs, they are looking at 60% of the funds will go into infrastructure from the government. That means the other 60%, other 40% will have to be generated through PPP mode, either PPP mode or from private investment, or from the center, from the states, ULBs, parastatal contributors, and all these will have to play in, and the center will meet the viability gap that there is in the projects. If you look at how a smart city actually is going to play itself out, I've called it the cities on steroids, because they require continuous augmentation. Unless they are pumped up with steroids, they cannot function, because they are going to be based on integrated ICT development. And ICT is something that gets outdated in 2 or 3 years. So it requires continuous upgradation. It requires huge maintenance costs. It requires large expertise at local levels to be able to deal with the maintenance and the upkeep of the systems. So it uses information and its public access as the instrument of good governance, because if information is not accessible to public, that's not good governance anymore. Because in the current scenario, where we are looking at a democratic framework through which we are delivering development, this access to information by public is a very critical factor. Then we have information that should be flowing two ways, people to local government and local government to people. We need the central theme of its finance is recovery. That is recovery of the money that's being spent either by government or by local bodies or by the private developer. And it's based on the user pay principle. That means the more money that goes into the system which actually goes as cash into the system, will have to be recovered and will have to be repaid by the user. Now, in the current scenario, we don't know where the money is coming from. It's coming from the taxpayers, an anonymous source from where this, the government, quote-unquote government, is pumping in the money, and we don't feel liable to pay it back, even though we are paying it back in some ways or the other. But here it will be pitched as a transactional logic. That transactional logic of spending the money and recovering it will have to be centrally pitched within the system so that the local bodies don't remain indebted. That indebtedness is a very serious condition, which has been largely also generated through the JNURM, because the money that is spent from the outside has to be recovered. Otherwise, if you can't repay that money back, you keep paying your interest. So basically, it has increased the indebtedness of local bodies considerably. And the more money, the more monetarily we conceptualize these projects, the more indebtedness will result from if it is not managed locally by recovery systems. Now, the issue of equity when you talk about recovery becomes a very critical factor. I will not dwell too much into it, but we all know that even the literacy on systems are limited. The best instrument is perhaps the cell phone, through which certain amount of information exchange can take place between the local body and the citizen, or the private companies and the citizen. Certain amount can be done through using the telephone, using the cell phone as an instrument, because now almost everyone has a cell phone, and cell phone can be an excellent instrument for communication, quick response. Apart from this, the other larger systems are going to be removed more and more from the people as they will get more and more specialized, and they'll require specialized huge investments to be able to make them function, upgrade them, maintain them, and make them viable for the municipal body. So technology that requires upgradation, maintenance, and capital, that makes continuous demand on the exchequer. This will have to be paid by the residents. Finally, yes, I understand the residents will have to pay it. Otherwise, who's going to pay it? Somebody has to pay it. And the Indian city is not an industrial IT estate. Very often, we mistake an industrial IT estate, industrial or IT estate, as a smart city. The examples which are being floated around today are those cities which are actually industrially or financially pitched cities. They are more or less monofunctional in their economic base, and that's not what an Indian city is made of. Indian city is a very, very diverse entity. And finally, over a period of time, these 100 smart cities or the smartened existing cities will have to finally approximate the Indian city over a period. It's inevitable unless they become islands of exclusion and islands of opulence within a continually impoverishing country. We have to make sure that these places are integrated and they become more and more diverse, and they're able to address more diverse population. They can't be just, you know, smart people in grey suits who can actually handle the ICT. It'll have to be more people than that who will have to finally manage it. Now, as a corollary to this is also an older mission, which is called the National Information Urban Information System, which is already in place. The monies which they are talking about is peanuts compared to this big money that we talk about today. This is like going back to 2006. And the objective is not very different from that of the smart city: develop spatial and attribute database, that is database which is based on specific attributes at the local level, then use modern data sources, develop standards, develop urban indices, and build capacity at state and local level. These are the five objectives laid out for the National Urban Information System, which actually is an approximation of the the smart city. Smart city is a larger, louder, bigger, more grandiose kind of scheme, whereas this was a smaller amount of allocation, smaller, less ambitious scheme, and it still has not fully played itself out. So there was an emphasis on generating geospatial data, and there were national urban information systems, cities based on 152 cities based and towns based on it, and what is called the Bhuvan portal. Bhuvan means global portal, and application and tools have been developed for formulation of master plans using these systems and facilitating creation of geospatial data, very, very parallel to what the smart city is attempting to do. In that same scheme between 2014 and 15, all these organizations like TCPO, Ministry of Urban Development, National Remote Sensing Agency, etc., have taken up three-level capacity building programs to familiarize personnel of state town planning departments on urban development authorities to these systems, which are based on higher and better technologies, which can lead to better urban planning. Now, the total scheme outlay was only 66.28 crores, which is peanuts compared to what the money that's being now talked about, and 75% of it to be borne by the central government, 25% to be borne by the state. Until up to December 2014, the central share of 42.92 crores has been released. The rest of the money is still not released in that scheme. So the smart city project will have to be pitched in a completely different scale, both in terms of how to expend the money and how to find its utilization on the ground. So though small in financial outlay, the NUISS, that is National Urban Information System, is highly consequential from the sustainability perspective, because it's the utilization of these new technologies which actually will help us finally manage the water balancing in cities, finally manage profiling of land and profiling of land uses and identifying new growth areas without damaging the... So now we come to the Hriday scheme, which is recently, this is the scheme, it's the first scheme that's actually been launched into ground. 12 cities have been identified under this Hriday scheme, that is Heritage City Development and Augmentation Yojana. This government, as you know, has a penchant for acronyms and nice acronyms. So Hriday also means the same thing. And these are the 12 cities that were identified spread across the country. And they've already been awarded to different organizations and NGOs to carry out the projects. And they've already had two meetings after that also. I happen to be a member of the National Advisory Committee of this, and therefore I have more information on this, but I'm not presenting all that information here. But the idea is a laudable idea, that in fact if you look at India, besides Chandigarh and Gandhinagar, every other Indian city has a heritage component, has a large heritage city embedded within its structure, or some of them are entirely heritage cities. So this can be a huge mission. 12 is nothing. 12 numbers is nothing. This is the first phase of the development, and subsequently the government has schemes to announce for more and more schemes, more and more areas to be developed. But it is not centrally pitched on conservation, which is a very significant shift from the earlier missions on. You know, under JNURM also you had a heritage cities program, but these Hriday projects are not pitched on conservation, but they are pitched on the interface between urban design and conservation, because conservation, pure conservation, falls under the Ministry of Culture, and if the Ministry of Urban Development is spending the money, it can't be treading on the toes of the Ministry of Culture. So it's pitched the whole program in such a way that it's more an urban design exercise that addresses the core fabric of a heritage city, rather than looking at spending these monies on heritage projects themselves. So that's a shift that's happened in the Hriday schemes from the earlier JNNURM-based schemes. But this is something which seems to be going forward at present. Now, the scheme strategies are these. That is, 100% funds coming from the center. That is, the central government has allocated a certain amount of money for this work. They have fixed the fees for the consultant who will be doing the work. So there is no financial tender. So those institutions like NGOs, etc., which some of them cannot pitch for a financial tender, they can also participate, because if they express their willingness and if they have the capacity to deliver, they can take on the projects, because there is no financial bid. There is only technical bid. So this is actually a great improvement on the whole scheme, because this has allowed the government to actually identify people who can deliver these projects and hand them the work. Since the fee is already fixed, those NGOs are also not embarrassed to be seen quoting for them for this work. They could express their interest in working on these projects. Then the cities will be required to prepare heritage management plan, develop DPRs for identified projects for availing the assistance under the scheme. So part of the work of the consultant is to develop this. First of all, develop a plan which will be a cross between urban design and conservation, urban conservation in some ways. They have to prepare that plan, as well as they have to develop a DPR to actually implement the project. Of course, it requires local capacity, like in any other scheme, and many of our local bodies currently don't have that capacity to do this. So we'll have to invent that part of the work. Now, heritage management plans and DPRs may be developed by national. They have identified who all can actually identify them. These are the people whom they have identified. And the project duration is for 4 years, starting from December 2014. So within four years, they have to implement these schemes with the money that is in place. And in most cases, it appears to us, those who are in the committee, that it will be possible to deliver a majority of these projects within that time. But meanwhile, government might choose to announce more cities, more heritage cities to be done. So NIUA is, of course, as usual, centrally pitched in coordinating this. It's designated as a national project management unit for this Hriday scheme and will function as a secretariat for mission directorate. And the city PMU will be procured by National Mission Directorate, that's NIUA, and will function as a secretariat to City Mission Directorate. There will be City Mission Directorate. There's a whole structure that's envisaged. I'll show you some detail of that. This is the financial outlay, which is not very much. If you look at them, if you look at the numbers, they are really peanuts compared to the kind of monies we have been talking about for smart cities and Hriday cities and so on. Banaras, which is the biggest beneficiary, gets 89 crores, and the smaller ones, which go up to 22.26 crores. The very small cities, like if you look at places like Amravati, they are really tiny villages with a kind of an urban face. They are not really cities. Well, there are many such cities which will get. Velangadni, for instance, is actually centered around one church. Yeah, so it's almost a village, almost approximating to a town, because of the popularity of pilgrimage that takes place there. It acquires the hues of a town. Otherwise, it's really not a town, but it's almost functioning at a village level. So they get smaller amounts of money. And this is the kind of structure that the implementation frame. There's a national advisory committee, in which I just told you that I'm a member. And there's the National Empowered Committee. I don't know exactly what is the role of this Empowered Committee. Probably Jagan can throw some light on it as to what this Empowered Committee will do. Then there's the National Mission Directorate, which is NIUA. Then you have a National Technical Committee, which will be proofing the projects which are being proposed. Now, there's a city-level advisory and monitoring agency at the local level. Then there will be a city mission directorate at the local level. And there will be heritage city anchors. These anchors are the organizations which have been given the projects. They'll act as the anchors for these projects. They don't own the projects, but they help anchor the project at the local heritage environment. I move on to the next critical project, which is Sardar Patel National Urban Housing Mission, which has proclaimed that there is a shortage of 18.78 million people in 2012, million households required to be built, and 75% of the estimated housing shortage is concentrated in 10 states. These are the state distribution that you find. They are largely concentrated in 10 states, and light green color, where only 4.47% is located, is the is all other towns together. After these 10 states, these are the states, smaller states where have small amounts of low-income housing. The numbers are given here. I won't go into more details. Now, by 2026, 40% of the population of India is expected to live in urban areas. It'll go to between 5.5 to 6 million people, 600 million people. And the urban poor is going to require maximum amount of housing. It's divided among slum dwellers, urban poor living in non-slum areas, prospective migrants, and homeless and the destitute. These are the divisions that they've used for this housing. And what you see here is the numbers, the urban population growth that is envisaged over the last 20 years. By 2011 is the last data we have. It's going to be as high as what you see here in the image. The increasing proportion of migrant population in the urban areas is also going to be aggravated by climate change. Now, as far as this mission is concerned, there are 13.78 million slum households across India. There are in-situ redevelopment and upgradation that is part of the housing policy. There's private partnership basis using land as a resource. That's using monetizing the land and then converting that monetization into housing finance and so on. There are quite a lot of details here. I won't go into more details. But not all slums are amenable to cross-subsidization. Some of them just won't be able to cross-subsidize. They'll require subsidy from some other sources. So the government of India and the state governments to share financial burden in case of viability gap by 60-75%. In case of there is a viability gap. In other words, they are expecting that most of the cost will be met by monetizing the land through a PPP mode. So that if there is a viability gap, that will be met in 60-75% between the center and the state. Now, we all know that the housing issues, once again, are vested with the state government. It's a state housing policy which actually impacts real-term creation of housing. And that's very often where the mismatch is between the state and the central dialogue on housing. Now, just because money is available, that doesn't mean that the state governments can actually deliver. Under JNURM, they've built quite a lot of housing, especially in Andhra Pradesh, they've built quite a lot of housing. Andhra was one of the biggest beneficiaries of JNURM as far as housing is concerned. And they have built quite a few houses, but some of them are still not occupied because their policies for allocation is not the best policy. So it's not only about creation of the asset, but it's also the issue of how do you allocate those assets, how do you manage those assets, how do you ensure that they function, the facilities that you provide within them will function. There are a large number of issues which need to be addressed in the housing scenario. Now, slums located on sites which are unfit for residential use, like riverbed, forest, etc., will have to be relocated to tenable sites. This is recognized in the policy, and state government ULBs will identify alternative land with civic and social infrastructure. So ULBs may receive a share of the GST which has been proposed at 14% that they're going to collect. Part of it is going to go to the ULB. That's what the minister had said, and I hope it actually plays itself out, because right now the ULBs have no source of money because their tax recovery system is so poor. They really have no money to pay even their employees, and they're functioning because it's very profitable for the employees in the small town who doesn't get a salary for 6 months from the government to find a salary from other sources locally, so which is what they do in running the local governments. So many of them are in a very, very depressing condition, and they'll require to be addressed through these projects to actually get money from the central tax pool so that they can initiate some of these projects. Now, there is a diagram here which shows how many of them are in the EWS category and how many are in the low income category. It works out to be 96% of the shortage is in the low income category. And our current policy for generating finances through monetizing land talks only about 10 to 15% of the land to be allocated for housing. How is this 10 to 15% going to address this 96% gap is for each state government to figure out how they're going to do it. The unfortunate thing is, while there is a lot of thinking and lots of economic think tanks at the central level, lots of institutions and organizations have been created to talk and think about economics at central level, there is a fraction of that available at state level. The state is actually unable to generate its own economic policy with the kind of vigor and rigor with which the center is able to do so. So center is providing this money, but the state actually doesn't have the capacity to negotiate that money. When it comes to the local body, it gets even worse. The ULB is not even capable of, as I said, paying salaries. So there is a very big mismatch or very big imbalance in the thinking about economics in the country, and that's one thing that needs to be addressed through these schemes. So these are more details on these. The critical thing is that climate refugees may be the new kind of refugee that you will find in the future. As climate change starts destroying the cropping patterns, it starts increasing the toxicity in soil, it starts increasing the insect population which actually attack housing, because as heat goes up, there's more and more reproduction among the insects. There are all kinds of ways in which climate change is going to impact migration. And that's a migration which is not part of any of these projections. That's a migration that we have to worry about in future. So all these graphs that you find will actually start shooting higher and higher as impact of climate change is taking place. So we need to have more additional taxes to GOI and state to help fund the mission. They want to increase more taxes to be able to fund this mission. So the idea is that the total investment will be 22.5 lakh crores within the next 7 years. It's a huge sum of money. And this is apart from all the other monies that we have talked about. And there are many other hidden schemes. There are many other economic schemes, banking concessions, various other kinds of economic provisions which will bring more money into the local area. There's FDI. There are all kinds of things which are opening up for the flow of money into the local area. How are we going to manage this is the question. Now, there is also a mission called the National Mission on Sustainable Habitat. I think I'm going overboard in terms of my time, so I'll be very quick. I won't read through this. Now, this in bolder form, I've put in this issue of the 4 FAR, which is first proclaimed in Maharashtra and then now subsequently in Delhi. And you can be sure that in no time, many other cities will follow suit on this 4FAR. Now, along with mixed use, if these are this 4FAR is applied to megacities, it can lead to a more compact city form. But what is the cost on infrastructure of this compact city form? Because even at present, our infrastructure is stretched to its limits, and this 4FAR is going to aggravate those limits. I'll move very quickly. I won't go into too much details. Now, total financial outlay for National Mission on Sustainable Habitat, which is actually commenced with the last government and is continuing, is an outlay of 54,181 crores. One loses count actually as it goes on, but this is the kind of money that's going to be poured in through the Sustainable Habitat Mission. Lastly, I look at the 74th Amendment and how the ULBs are impacted by the 74th Amendment. Now, as you all know, there are three levels at which it is conceived, and the 12th schedule in the 74th Amendment actually defines 18 new tasks in the functional domain of the urban local body. I'm coming to my conclusive chapters. First is urban planning, including town planning. It's supposed to be a local body function, but it's not. Yeah, it's not happened at all. In Delhi, of course, it was subverted. In 1998, there was a government order which said Delhi will not fall under the 74th Amendment. It was Delhi which actually changed the constitution to bring about 74th Amendment, and very quickly they exempted Delhi from it so that land can remain with DDA and the center. So Delhi is the first sign of distortion, but in other places, for various other reasons, they have not been implemented properly. Then regulation of land use and construction of buildings is a local body function. In other words, central to planning. Then planning for economic and social development, roads and bridges, water supply for domestic and industrial commercial purposes, public health, sanitation, conservancy and solid waste management, fire services, urban forestry, protection of the environment and promotion of ecological aspects. All these are local body functions, yeah, not of the state or any other larger kind of, you know, big think tanks, but this is the elected local body which has to perform these functions. Then safeguarding the interests of weaker sections of society, including handicapped and mentally retarded, slum improvement upgradation, in other words, those monies which are going to come in the national housing scheme is going to be pitched onto the local body. Then urban poverty alleviation, all the approach that is being taken for looking at new missions for urban livelihood missions are also going to be pitched at the local body level. Then provisions of urban amenities and facilities such as parks, gardens and playgrounds. Then promotion of cultural, educational and aesthetic aspects. These are all supposedly on paper under the 74th Amendment local body functions. Yeah. So you can see already how badly burdened they are and how they are underperforming on these criteria. Now, in such a scenario, think of the kind of money that's going to come. Yeah. Now, burial grounds, crematoriums, cremation grounds, and electric crematoriums, cattle pounds, prevention of cruelty to animals, which is actually now become a very big central issue. They have to protect the animals on the street. Which is a good thing. If they can protect the animals, it's a great thing. I think we should have animal protection as centrally enshrined in all these schemes so that we just don't, you know, destroy that most interesting, softest part of the Indian city. I prefer a cow on the road any day to a truck. So they have to look after cattle pounds, vital statistics including registration of births and deaths, public amenities including street lighting, parking lots, bus stops and public conveniences, regulation of slaughterhouses and tanneries. over and above this complex set of duties, the ULB also now also must deal with the conversion of the avalanche of investment into, have to convert that into public interest. Now, that is how heavily the urban local body is going to be loaded. These are not just imagined things. These are actually written down in the 12th schedule as the functions of the local body. There's an image which shows how, in fact, all these schemes that we discuss now and many more are going to converge on the urban local body. They emanate at the central level. They pass through the state. The state negotiates the money, and then it comes on to the zone. Now, do our ULBs have the capacity to absorb the pressures of these missions is a question. Where did the JNNURM fail is also a question. I think these two questions are critical to see how all these big investments that we are talking about, where is it going to converge? And how are we going to deal with that convergence? Not that there are no solutions. There are solutions. And I have a few suggestions towards that. I'll quickly go through them. These are my last two slides. First is devote 1 year and sufficient funds to build capacities of the ULBs and state governments. Just don't think about implementation from today. Train people to implement. I think that's the most critical thing. They don't have the capacity to deal with the money. They don't know how to talk to a consultant. They don't know how to approach a bank. They don't know how to fill forms. They don't know how to collect tax. They don't know how to charge people for, you know, kind of utilities. They can't go to the electorate and say, tomorrow you're going to pay for your water. You'll get kicked out of the electorate next day. So there's no way they're going to confront it. So they need training at that level to be able to confront it. So this, I would say, is the most critical thing is the capacity building at the local level. Now, we need to design local economic models for different funding modes, because depending on the funding mode, you need different patterns of funding. Now, as I said, there's a lot of centralized thinking on economics in the country. There are lots of brilliant people around who can think everything through from the center, but there is no capacity at the local level to deal with that money. So we have to train people in, depending on the funding mode, they require specific targeted training on how to deal with this money. How do you design recovery systems, etc. Then you need to create urban design cells at ULBs to protect quality of life, public spaces, and aesthetic quality. Otherwise, you will find that slowly all the critical land in the municipal areas will be appropriated by private investment, and there will be access control systems all over the city, and all public assets will become alienated from people unless public areas are protected through urban design. Of course, to build capacities at the design and planning level is one of the objectives of many of these missions, but we need to translate that into three-dimensional, doable things on the ground, not some kind of a colored land use plan. Now, we need to revisit the present plan formulation and delivery to include the mission mode. The present planning mode is not on the mission mode. Present planning system is a leftover from the Nehruvian thinking of the socialist state delivering a good plan to its citizens. It doesn't work that way anymore. That's not how cities are growing. Cities are growing in very different ways. And the plan formulation has to be pitched to include the mission mode as a delivery system so that you have targeted time, targeted money, targeted project, targeted beneficiaries, and ensure that public good emanates from that investment. Then you need to build in climate resilience through environmental regulations at the local level. There is no one at the local level who can actually enforce an environmental regulation. If an NGO makes a noise about it, they are seen as anti-development, and they are either stopped by the local politicians or by the municipality or by the state. So that is because there is no effective arm at the governance level who can deal with the protection of the environment. That's very critical. If this money is going to go pour into these cities, you can be sure that all the ponds and talabs in the country will go. They'll vanish. And you will get housing scheme coming up on top of it. This is unencumbered land, which will be with the government. So a lot of the catch basins, the riverside development, lots of things are going to happen because this money is going to flow in. So it requires local capacity to protect those. Then, this is my last slide. We need to build capacities in the political leadership to protect local interests within external investments. When external investments come in, how do you protect local interest? That is a political decision. It's not a decision that's taken by the technocracy or the bureaucracy. It's a political decision that needs to be taken at that level. So politicians need to be trained. Politicians also need capacity building. Then we need to recast the regional planning scenarios to introduce smart systems across different segments at national level. For instance, if you look at movement of goods, if you look at movement of, you know, energy resources across the country, if you look at food supply from the grower to the mandis to the cities and distributions and so on, if you look at all those systems, it is those systems that we have to smarten. If we don't smarten those systems, the cities are not going to be smart. You will simply get isolated islands of controlled by ICT, and you will get areas which are full of poverty. So we are going to increase that unless we actually manage at the regional level and sub-regional level and even at national level, those systems which actually facilitate the functioning of an urban center. We all know the apples which are produced in Himachal first comes to Delhi, and it gets redistributed from Delhi back to Himachal. That's how it works. So all these wholesale markets, for instance, the way they are functioning and the movement of goods on roads, the control of these trucking systems, all this can be brought into smart systems. If we can bring those systems into smart zone, then we'll have smart functioning cities from the external perspective, from the regional perspective. Of course, you need to look at how it plays out at local level in terms of urban spaces as well. Then we need to look at, we need to enhance the local livelihoods to benefit from external investment. When external investment comes in, they are interested in quick recovery. And you can't fault them for it. People who come with money want it back as quickly as possible. So investment will first go into places where it can come back quickly. And how does one protect public interest? How does one make sure that this money actually generates jobs locally? That is a smart move that needs to be made at the local level. Then at the ULB level, we need to build capacity to professionalize land management, construction, and financial transactions. The ULB has no clue as to how to manage land. We know how various pressures and pulls from political circles finally determine in which directions projects grow and where it grows. Take case of city, look at Dwaraka. How was Dwaraka set up? Dwaraka was set up originally invented by a politician. A politician who used to get 2 rupees for every cement bag which entered the city. He was keen to see that the consumption of cement in the city is upped, and he called 13 societies to be formed, fake societies, actually formed by developers. And then with that, they approached DDA and said, make a plan. DDA refused to do it. It was outsourced to SPA. When SPA did a plan, that was finally absorbed into the master plan because of the political pressure. It was just a question of a political decision. It was not a planning decision. Now, if in the 1970s, when there was no such financial pressures, if something like that could happen, you can imagine what will happen now when there's so much of financial thrust which is going to come into local bodies. So land management, construction, and financial transaction management is going to be a very critical part of local governance. And this is an area where we need serious capacity building. Then, finally, we also have to invest in smart people. If we reduce the outlay for education, and if you reduce the outlay for health, That's not going to make a smart country. That's going to make a sick country. And a sick country cannot produce smart cities. It's only a healthy country which can produce smart cities. So I think when you say healthy, it means an educated, a certain level of health in the mind of the people and in their physique. Of course, day after tomorrow we have a big yoga camp. I think that's a very good move. I think it's a great move because it's important that we start getting centered as people. But unfortunately, at the same time, the same government is reducing the outlay on education. It's reducing the outlay on health services. Now, that's not going to help. So unless the yoga can substitute for all the health care that we do, that we all do yoga and therefore we won't get sick and we don't need health centers, then that's a different thing. But that's not what's going to happen. So unless we invest in people, in human resources, we can't create smart cities, we can't create projects, so many projects which are actually going to be effectively playing out on the ground to the benefit of the people. So that is my last slide. And I hope, I'm sorry that I took too much time. I could have gone on for longer, but thank you very much. Thank you all for listening to me.
Thank you, Katie. I think that was a centering in itself, bringing us back to sort of grounding us in the fact that all of this needs to converge at the local level, and does the city and do the citizens actually have the capacity to absorb so much investment and participate in an ambitious scale of urbanization. It is interesting you mentioned about the cement business in Delhi. I was told today that after water, the second highest consumed commodity is cement in the world. So I think it was an appropriate point about seeing cement as an indicator of the way things are. With that, I think we do need to move on, and I would invite Dr. Shravan Acharya to share his thoughts with us, as you wish, if you'd like to stand and speak. Yeah, that's fine.
thank you, Professor Jagan. Thank you, Professor Ravindran, because you have given a very elaborate, you know, presentation on urban scenario and the future agendas. And I think it is a good platform to share, you know, and give a different perspective to some of the issues that is confronting us in the context of sustainable urbanization that we are talking about in this country. Interestingly, when I got the invitation from NIUA and I was going through the flyer, some word was very interesting and it caught my attention. Some of these words were, you know, reimagine. I think it is a very strong word and a very appropriate word, but I think we also need to understand who is reimagining for whom. I think that is very critical, because unless we understand the imagination process, who is imagining for whom, I think then we will not be addressing the right issues. Therefore, I feel that when you are talking about the cities in today's context in India, it is very critical to understand who formulates, who reimagines or imagines, and for whom. The other point which hit me quite strongly was the word convergence. And there were two words which were used, political and economic. And I thought that was, again, very appropriate. Because if you see in the last, from 2000 or 1995 onwards, with regards to urban and urbanization, especially from 2005 onwards, there has been certain degree of convergence between the political processes in this country and the economic philosophy of this country. If you see both, you know, India is a democratic country. We change parties based on their, you know, performance. In the last 10 years, both the parties, whosoever has come to power, has always given importance to this process of urbanization as a growth model for India's future. So when the, you know, UPA government initiated the JNNURM process in the country, I think that was a very critical phase. I think for the first time in independent India, I think the urban discourse became very central in the political debates and also in terms of urban development processes. Otherwise, it was always peace versus rural versus urban. But I think 2005, the JNNURM brought urban back into the agenda or into the agenda of the whole political discourse or development discourse in this country. And today, when we talk about the new government and when they talk about Amrut, frankly, I don't see any difference between what they talked in JNNURM and what we see today in Amrut. So therefore, there is a convergence in terms of political interest in terms of giving importance to urban. The other more interesting importance, and that is what the theoretical framework that we need to understand in the context of urban development is, I think, with the, you know, like the failure of the left or the socialism, whatever we may call in India, I think the neoliberal development agenda has brought urban into focus very sharply. Therefore, the whole context of development that we see talk about in India today, about urban development, has to be seen in the context of the neoliberal urban agenda or the development agenda that we see all over the world. So when we talk about JNNURM or Amrit or smart cities, and when we say they will compete with each other to access finance, what we are talking about is a neoliberal market-oriented, you know, planning mechanism or development mechanism. And that begets a major question. If you are talking about, you know, urban development in a competitive mode, and you are talking about, say, 100 smart cities or, you know, 76, you know, cities in JNNURM, and you say that, one wonders how many of them will be able to compete with each other. Do they have the competitive base itself? And what are the government going to do about it? So this is one thing which I thought, I think I need to make it clear, because unless we understand this whole processes that is taking place, then it will be very difficult for us to understand what will be the future agenda for urban development in this country. Then in the last flyer of the, you know, the word was ULB, and it was very nicely written whether they will be able to convert, you know, some of this opportunity into public good for the good of the citizen. Now the professor has very nicely narrated the weaknesses of the ULB. Now just imagine a situation where we have 4,000 odd, you know, urban local bodies, some big, some small, some very, very small, and some are called as a census categories with census towns, which has not even the statutory, you know, labeling that is required. So what we are talking about is if the UL body, urban local body, has to, you know, convert the opportunities provided by globalization and development processes, to convert these into public good for the citizen, the ULB has to be really efficient and really good. And as the story that we just heard, how many of our local bodies are so efficient to convert many of the opportunities into public good? And when you talk about public good, one thing we have to be very clear about. All of us are in Delhi. Every Saturday and Sunday, when we open the Times of India, Hindustan Times, we heard a big label, Rahagiri in CP, Rahagiri in Dwarka. Now it is happening in Ahmedabad. You know, and what do you tell, what is the public good access to that? They say they are trying to recapture the streets. The roads are meant to be for people. And when you disaggregate, you know, Rahagiri and see the participation of the people, it is nothing but the middle class, you know, citizen of these cities who is participating in this public good, if you call it, in terms of capturing the street. Have you ever, I've gone to some of these Rahagiris in, you know, because out of my interest and curiosity, what happens in there. Frankly, I think this is the time in India when urbanization is taking place, the middle class is having an awful good time. That is as it is. So when you talk about Rahagiri and you analyze the situation, because I think Rahagiri is a reflection of the aspiration of urbanization processes that is taking place in this country. So when you analyze that, with all type of activities taking place, and imagine Delhi 50% of the people living in slums, Bombay 55%, what percent of the people do they participate in this particular process? Of course, this is not the full story, but this is a symbol of the type of urbanization that is taking place in this country. I think we need to understand that. So therefore, this particular words, which was, you know, in the flyer, I thought that very nicely reflects and captures, at least tries to translate, you know, and give us some thought about the development process that is taking place in the cities. Now let me get back to some of the points highlighted by Professor Ravindran. Now, you know, there are some of these schemes like which the government has initiated. Now let me, one thing before I get into this, today's India's urbanization is around 31%, right? And all over the world, if you see the historical experiences of the countries, 30 to 50% has been the most critical phase. When 30% to 50%, and Professor rightly said, is it a crisis? I think it depends upon whether you see it. Certainly it is a crisis if you can't manage it, but if you can manage it, maybe it is also an opportunity. So therefore, this particular period, when you are in 31% to maybe the 50% of urban population, I think is going to be very, very critical for India. And therefore, we need to think very, very clearly how to address these issues. Now, in the context of this, you know, some of the schemes which were highlighted, I think the Amrut, which was basically an extension, I think it is basically an extension of the JNNURM with some modification. The smart cities, national urban information systems, RIDAI, housing mission, national mission, 74th Amendment Act, which was, of course, it precedes much more before, and I think I also give a lot of input. But if you look into these schemes, you know, I wonder sometimes how integrated are they with each other? Because when you are talking about, you know, sustainable habitat, will that not also include housing? Now, I include housing. There is also a debate about Swachh Bharat mission. And many a times, I find that the discourse about Swachh Bharat mission is only about toilets. Right? I think that is not the issue. If you don't have a house, there is no point giving a toilet. So I think when we are talking about schemes, you know, there are so many different schemes in urban India today, but the question is, how integrated are they in terms of each other? Have we been able to converge these schemes into one so that it has much more effective and efficient impact to the population which we are giving? Now I can cite an example, you know, based on some of the work, like wherever the urban bodies, even if it is a small project, I can give example of Ahmedabad where there was the slum networking project, which was one of the most successful projects, at least in terms of urban slum upgradation initiative. One of the reasons why that particular project was successful was, besides involving the community, you know, the microfinance initiative, the partnership model, it also successfully converged different schemes, and I remember that one of them was the toilet scheme. You know, it converged the whole thing into one particular scheme and then delivered it, and it became successful. So therefore, when we are talking about different schemes, I think it is very important for us to understand how do we conceptualize and how do we integrate them as, you know, in a one particular model and deliver it. Of course, I have my own take on smart cities, and I think Professor has rightly highlighted some of these issues and the weaknesses about this. And I fully agree, sir, with you, when you said about the regional thing, I fully understand that, and I really appreciate that, because, you know, you can't have one smart cities or 100 smart cities in a country with 4,000 urban areas. I think what we need to think about is a cluster of smart cities which are linked with each other so that mobilities of factors of production like land, labor, and capital moves. Then only there is going to be an economic integration. Today, if you are talking about network of cities, and if the network doesn't have flows of information or flows related to capital and other factors of production, I think one smart city is not going to make a difference to us. In fact, what is going to happen in a larger context is one smart city is going to connect it to global smart cities, and in the process, that city, if you remember the old, you know, like urban dialogue where we used to talk about the political economy of, you know, like Paul Baran and others used to talk about siphoning or the enclave cities. They would basically act as siphoning our resources in a new format from our system to the metropolitan capital of the world. So I think what we need to talk about is, when you are talking about smart city concept, I think we need to think about a regional smart city network. Then I think that is going to make a difference. See, the discourse, urban discourse, is not about cities only. It is about urbanization processes. And I think we need to remember this very clearly. It is not about one city, two city. It is about urbanization and urbanization processes. And please remember, when you are talking about urbanization, we normally tend to forget the issues of inequalities, the spatial inequalities which this country faces. If, and all of us know that urban areas play a very important role in addressing regional inequality issues. So if we don't address cities as a system to address some of these regional issues, I think that is not going to solve our problem. And that is exactly going to happen what Professor was talking about. If you analyze the JNNURM front utilization process, it is only few cities in few developed states like Gujarat, Ahmedabad, Bangalore in Karnataka, and Maharashtra. These were the few cities which could use the resources effectively. Most of the other states could not use it. I also say this with a little bit of conviction because I happen to work in the mountain areas and the Northeast. In all of our discourse, what happens is many a times our urbanization debate is centered around few areas on the, you know, mainland urban areas, and many of the large chunk of areas which are backward or in the hinterland are often ignored. We need to ask what role the smart cities can play in developing some of these areas. Can we do something about it? In a way, smartness is also incremental. In fact, many of the smart components are already included in our urban planning or urban development processes. And there is a very, you know, like old saying that Rome was not built in a day. Similarly, cities can't build in a day. I think cities, smart cities, are very incremental processes. When industrial revolution took place, I think cities like Detroit, Philadelphia, you know, like Chicago, were all considered smart. Today, they are considered to be dead cities. Cincinnati is declining. Most of the Northeast US cities are declining. Why? Once upon a time, they were much smarter than any other cities. I think the reason is that we have not been able to understand that smartness is incremental. What is smart today may not be smart tomorrow. The fact that cities have not been able to, you know, like, compete and enhance technologies over a period of time reflects how smart they will be in future. So the concept of smartness has to be seen in an incremental basis. How can we plug in small little things? I think the initiative taken by many cities like, you know, e-filing of, you know, like taxes and all, I think they are good. The challenge is, can we plug in small, such small initiatives so that it reflects into larger good? That is the challenge. It is not about building one smart city, a greenfield city. So I think that is one of the issues that, you know, we need to think about. So therefore, incremental smartness. The other thing about, you know, taking up from professors, you know, about the efficiency of urban, look at the, you know, like, disconnect between what we, on the one hand, when we are talking about, you know, like urbanization, we are talking about, you know, giving new schemes, but we also know that because we have not implemented the 74th Amendment Act properly, the cities are not functioning effectively. Now look at what is happening. All of us know that urban local bodies can act effectively only if they are politically empowered and financially empowered. But There is also a constitutional mandate to form finance commission, and all of us know how many states have effectively formed the finance commission and how they are getting implemented. But the more interesting challenge is, when the words like cooperative federalism is talked about, one is only talking about the center and the state relationship. Nobody is talking about the local bodies. Now look at the cooperative federalism that is talking about. Many of the central schemes which was so far directly transferred to the local bodies actually was useful for the local bodies because they were accessing resources from the center. Now, because many of the central funders are going to the state, the question is, will the state transfer these resources to the local body? So are we empowering the local body, or are we, you know, like disempowering? I think that is one of the issues that we need to think about. Or regarding, you know, I'll just pick a few. I hope I have some time. Okay. Just a few more points. One another thing is about, you know, like this heritage issues, and I think many of these, even in JNNURM that was faced. I think the challenge in this country is about the urban development program. It is also about institutions and legal, you know, like provisions. Now, say for instance, the heritage mission talks about developing heritage. But we also know that our heritage are governed by the old Archaeological Survey of India's Acts. That is one there. The other one, we talk about, you know, like smart cities, competitive cities, which talks about modern planning provisions. And here we have a conflict. Now, there are certain provisions in the Act which doesn't allow certain type of development in this particular area. How did you address these issues? So unless, I think one of the challenges for convergence of some of these schemes is that how do we reform institution laws and legal provisions that is related to the urban in India? I think if you don't do that, I think it is going to be a major, major issue in addressing some of these urban related challenges. And lastly, I think I'll just emphasize one aspect relating to the empowerment and citizens' participation. Again, I think the point that I think India is one of the only countries in the world which has constitutionally mandated empowering of the local bodies through the Constitutional Amendment Act. But I don't think we have been able to do that as it was indicated, because the urban development is a state subject. Therefore, many of the powers have not been, you know, like devolved to the local bodies. Now the challenge is, I think we realize that, and therefore there is a disconnect when you are talking about the political convergence point of view. I think there is a disconnect when you are talking about the state empowering the local bodies. Will they be effectively able to do that? I think so far that has not happened. And unless and until the political, you know, the decentralization takes place and empowers the local bodies, I think that is not going to, you know, empower or address the challenges of urban development in this country. I think that is one thing which we need. So therefore, we may be able to devolve certain responsibilities to the local body, but if you don't devolve the powers, and including the financial powers, to the local bodies, I think many of the schemes that we have narrated or highlighted that is going to address these issues are never going to be resolved. And I think that is one of the major challenges that we have to understand. Many a times in the whole discourse about urban development and many of the schemes, including heritage and all, we feel that the PPP model is one of the ways to go about it. The central, you know, the state moves away from its responsibility. One of the interesting things happening in India is that, you know, like state as a facilitator of public good in urban body itself is, you know, it is moving away. In fact, the fact that private sector prepares the plan, okay, for many of the urban bodies itself is a reflection of that, you know, disconnect that is emerging. Now we need to understand how effective is PPP in terms of addressing some of these issues. Will it be effective in terms of addressing the housing issues, I think the sanitation issues? I think these are some of the challenges that we really need to reflect. And I think one of the points that was highlighted was that, you know, like, I think if you look into, you know, the history of the urban local bodies in India, I think with the passage of time, the urban local bodies, their functions, the powers and functions, actually their effectiveness has gone down tremendously. And one of the reasons is also because the population has not only increased, but some of the powers which was devolved to them has also been eroded over a period of time. I think so, therefore, some of these things I think we really need to understand. I think unless and until, I think the most important thing is that unless and until we empower the local bodies effectively, not only in terms of only, you know, like giving them a lot of responsibilities, but also in terms of financial devolution and all that, I think we are not going to address these issues of, you know, like making our cities sustainable. So I think that is the most critical issue. And I think if we do that, many of the issues get resolved in, I think, implementing the program successfully. Thank you. I think there will be more questions for that.
Thank you. Thank you, Shravan. We do have a little time to take a few questions, and then I'll request Professor Ravindran to respond. I just request that it should be a question, and please restrict it to one single question.
I have a question addressed to Katie, actually. You talked about, you know, at the end of your thing about training of urban local bodies and people, you know, making people smart. I was wondering if there's any government policy for training of policymakers.
This is a larger question of the shift, which both Katie as well as Acharya have raised it, of moving from the 300 million to the 600 million, and all in a short period of 2 to 2.5 decades' time. Even this 300 million is occupying only about 4% of India's urban. All these cities together contributing to 75% of GDP, only 4% of India's land mass. So if you're going to double this population from 300 million to this one, are we thinking in terms of the land mass getting expanded to 8%? Or are you thinking of going vertical? Either you can go vertical, this additional population, or into new cities. But this is where you can remember also Charles Correa, where he thought of these 500 gems to be created as to take care of. He had envisioned in 1992 itself in the report that you're going to grow. And what we see over here at this point of time, he could envision that. He indicated very clearly, you got to create this 500 gems, generators of economic movement in the urban space in terms of new land area. That means your urban land footprint has to, in the context of this new big drama going around land acquisition related issues, which has now become a major, major issue. You think, is a feasible option going to, where is it going to lead to? Or is it going to be high densification of going vertical, as you said, 1.5 to 4 FAR and other related area, which will create other problems?
First, to respond to Ashish's question. I think there are a large number of training programs for the policymakers already in place. But they are being trained more in running the governmental apparatus rather than in projecting a vision for the growth of the urban areas. So many of them are moved around. In 3 years, they get transferred to a new location, and a man who's an expert in urbanization will become, in 3 years' time, will become an expert in animal husbandry or on some non-economic agenda or somewhere else. So there is a constant change that happens. And there are few people like Shiva Ramakrishnan who actually sustained his interest in the area, and he built a whole lifetime of work around him. And those are the people, I think, who need to be emulated by people who are involved, policymakers who are involved in urban development. I cannot actually give you facts and figures because I'm not part of the government on how much of money is being spent in training the trainers, like you said, or training the policymakers, but they certainly have a large agenda for capacity building in local bodies, in state governments, etc. And a lot of those projects are parked at the NIUA. So there is, every one of the points that I raised in those 10 issues is actually an area of training in which they already have a hand. NIUA already has a hand in it. Only thing is that where have we built the capacity of the policymakers who will actually train these people? That is also a question. So it's a very valid question, but I don't really have an answer to that question.
I think it was a rhetorical question. Now Muni will say, who will train NIUA? Very rightly so.
So to answer Suresh's question, which is a far more complex kind of question, I think Suresh is in the center of training the ULBs. In fact, I'm sure he could have given a much better presentation than I have done on ULBs. But the issue that he raised is something that the government is trying to address in many ways. But the problem is that the implementation arm is not half as informed as the policy arm. The implementation arm, whether it is the delivery of the central functions to or collaboration between the state and the center in generating the implementation, there is massive gaps in capacity there itself. There is something called the Interstate Council, which is a part of the government, but they are addressing more like, quarrels between states on water management and all that kind of thing. So we don't really have a situation where these capacities are actually transferred on an organized footing. That's why I was suggesting that we should have 1 year and a large chunk of the money that's allotted only on training, to begin with training people. In other words, invest in the human beings first. If you invest in the human being, it can turn into investment in various other forms. And I think that's very, very central to the whole question that has been raised by Suresh as well. Would you like to add something to his question?
I think regarding urban, one of the thing about urban is the policymakers. One of the sad thing about in India is we don't even have a proper urbanization and urban policy. So therefore, that is one of the issues that before we talk about policymakers, we don't have a policy. We have, different. In fact, one of the most elaborate thing was the National Commission on Urbanization report, which in fact, was a good document, I feel. And I also agree that as far as the policymakers are concerned, I think there needs to be, more than the generalists, we need some specialists to, head the institutions, which gives direction in terms of urban development in the country. And I think that is critical. So therefore, certainly there is a need. And I think expert needs to be inducted at the level of policy making. I think bureaucrats are certainly good. Bureaucrats are good because they bring in a lot of field experiences. But I think in policies, not only field, but also some degree of conceptualization and theorization are important, which is lacking in India. Because when you talk to a bureaucrat, and when you try to conceptualize, I think many a times they are more interested in how do you solve the problem. Well, how do you solve the problem? I think that is, that is also a very ad hoc and a reactive way of doing it. I think we need to think beyond that. The other question that you talked about is about 3% of urban area, 4%. I think if you go by that statistics, suddenly it looks very small. And then we wonder why this big debate about, densification and high-rise building. The issue is, the 4% where? Is it the cultivable area? I think that is an issue. And if you talk about, say, for instance, large urban areas in and around Delhi, say, the way the land conversions are taking place. So at a larger level, it doesn't tend to make many sense. But if you see in terms of little, you know, like futuristic tradition trends that is taking place, say the DMIC corridors, the high intensity transport corridors, I think that if we don't regulate that, that is going to be a major issue. Because most of the corridors, if you see, run through some of the most fertile areas in the country. So therefore, the challenge is not about 4%. I think certainly that is too small. In fact, China is much better than India, because though China has less cultivable area than India has, but if you see the future growth trajectories taking place along the corridor, and if you rightly highlighted about the land acquisition problem, I think that is going to be the critical issue. I think that we haven't even thought about that.
Can I add one more thing to it? I think I'd like Suresh to draw your attention to the recently failed development plan for Bombay. That, why did that plan fail? Why did the government have to retract from it and cancel the plan? That plan was prepared by one of the topmost planners, current planners of the country, Mr. Pathak. He was at the center of it, and it is outsourced to a very well-known organization to do. But they came up with this idea of having 8 FSI in some places in Bombay. They proposed 8 FSI in some places. And where you don't even have the capacity to sustain 1.5 or 2 FSI. Already the infrastructure is breaking down. So these are examples of how this whole debate between land consumption and going high, etc., are in a very, very raw level in the country. And of course, Bombay's citizens, to their credit, that they rose up in arms and they protested against this plan, and the government was forced to shut that plan down. And of course, they are trying to give it a lease of life by extending the time to be able to revisit it. So the fundamental questions which were there in that plan about land and development are actually not addressed, because the people who actually commissioned the plan don't know what the consequences of those plans are, their decisions are. If you ask the planner, they say, sorry, it's a political decision that the FSI has to be 4. We have to demonstrate that it's viable. Everything is possible. Everything is viable, provided you have the backup to make it viable. There's huge gaps in infrastructure.
Since you raised the Mumbai one, can you take a minute, please? Since you raised the Mumbai one, which also coincided with the same time when beyond the Navi Mumbai was from 1970 to now 2000, about 50 years time period. There again, Charles Correia played an important role, including D'Souza, J.B. D'Souza. But now that's only about 337 square kilometers of area. But the new Naina area is about 657 square kilometers, which is more than double the area of the Navi Mumbai development, close to the new airport coming.
Yes.
So when that comes with about 1.7, very pretty close to the figure that you said, is going to the FAR in that area. So why do you do the 8 and 10 in this area? Also, one which triggered series of questions from the other lobby which objected to that. I just thought I should put you in a context.
This is actually a very central debate to urban development. You know, what is a compact city?
Yeah.
How high is compact? How viable is it from the energy security perspective? There are hundreds of questions which need to be addressed only through form. Unfortunately, the policymakers or the decision makers do not understand the importance of form, city form, and they just absolutely see, unless that kind of a three-dimensional approach is done, you cannot even assess the kind of demand that will be raised in the services in the city. It's all connected to form. It's the number of floor area, the amount of floor area that you need to support, which actually generates your requirement for infrastructure, actually generates your requirement for social infrastructure. Because that means that you can translate that very easily into, we are now involved with NIUA on a project in Navi Mumbai on this, and we are actually in the thick of the discussion on that. But the issue is that, you know, this whole statistical approach to land, that it is only that percentage, so we need to get more land. Can we house double this population in the present land, etc., etc.? It's that bypasses this discussion about quality of life that you deliver in a city. And I think what we need to address centrally is the quality of life. And quality of life cannot be addressed by statistics. It can only be addressed by design. It's a larger debate, Suresh. I'll be happy to continue this sometime. But yes.
My question, the substratum of the question was dealing with the fact, which I think Professor Acharya did raise, is that is there a philosophy about urbanization? That's really the substratum of the question. We're all talking about only instrumentalities. What is driving us?
Good evening. My question is related to, my name is Rajit Matthews. I work in the urban development space. So I was just looking at the presentation in terms of various schemes. My question is whether it was the JNURM or whether it's the smart cities agenda. These are all getting more and more stronger in terms of a central government agenda, in terms of what they determine cities and states should do. And at the same time, we're talking about decentralization, devolving, cities know what they need, you know, people at local scales know what they need. So in our federal system, hence, what should be the role of the center versus the state? Should the center have so much control on money and the framing of projects and what standards should be at local levels, or should it be the other way around? So my question is, what should be the final roles? Thank you.
This villages which get trapped while urbanizing, in urban villages. So what about policy for them, and how do you control them?
Okay, thank you. So Katie, Muni's question first. Is there a philosophy? Reggie's question about whether the center's role, I suppose these are actually these questions can come together, and whether we're thinking about the villages that come in the footprint.
So I think Muni Ganjo's question about is there a policy or is there a philosophy that is driving our urbanization at present, I think no. I don't think there is any one central concept in driving us. If you look at all these number of initiatives which I've described, this is nothing, it's the tip of the iceberg. There's so many other policies which are happening in terms of transportation. These corridors which are being planned, there are so many corridors being planned. There are corridors of railway corridors being planned as new development agenda. There are many corridors which are connecting. There's one connecting from Calcutta to Chennai, one connecting Chennai to Bangalore, one connecting Hyderabad to Bangalore, one connecting Mumbai to Delhi. There are so many such corridors happening. Apart from this, there are corridors which are going to connect, rail corridors which are going to connect there. I think they're called, what are they called? Diamond corridors or something like that. They're called diamond corridors, which is a completely different project centered around railway and its investment. So there are many of these corridors which are happening. Now, what is all these adding up to? Does this add up to a cogent region-based plan? It's not adding up to that. On top of it, we have these huge investments going through all these schemes into different locations. And there are, of course, as part of the national missions, 8 missions which are founded at the UPA time, there is also one on there's a transport mission as well. So there are so many different missions. I've just touched on few of them to simply show how the local body is going to be playing the role. Meaning in these corridors issues and all, the local body is not central to this. Local bodies will be formed on the new cities which will be coming up on these corridors. So I only highlighted those, selected those which actually will impact directly the local body's functioning. But we have hundreds of other plans which are completely unconnected. The problem is after that 1988 National Urbanization Commission, which, as Suresh rightly pointed out, still set the ground rules for our discourse even today. We are talking about small and medium towns. We're talking about investing in what is called GEMS in that, generators of spurs, germs. There were so many terminologies which are used. to show that there needs to be a balanced regional development. That was the last we heard of any kind of a philosophy about planning. After that, we have simply had plans and plans which are driven by profiteering and nothing else on monetization of land, nothing else. Where is the actual vision about the quality of life and the human beings that we are dealing with? What kind of Indians will we actually generate through these cities? Those are critical questions. And it needs to be bound by a central philosophy. And that actually is the role of the center, as I would say, is to actually envision that connectedness in the country to see how we can grow as a subcontinent. It is that connectedness that the central role should be. Now, the only role the center is now able to play in the absence of thinking is to dole out more money. We have seen this kind of pumping of money into the economy is not the solution. JNURM has proved it beyond any doubt that the more money that you pump in, the more messy the local situation becomes. We have seen that happen. But still, what is the recourse that is left with the center in the absence of a cogent philosophy about development? The only thing they can do is to have this kind of missions which are within the, you know, co-terminus with electoral deadlines, and that's what you get now. And the state governments are just thinking that, okay, this money is coming, so why not take it, without realizing that it has to be paid back. There are no free lunches. Somebody pays for it. And the state will, and the local body finally, or the local people have to pay that money back. Now, the problem is that as much as there is concerted thinking at the central level on the economics of the flow of money into these various systems, there is no such thinking at state level and no such thinking at local level. We don't even have a proper recovery system that's been ever designed in this country for the poor people to be able to pay back for what they get. They don't need subsidy. They can afford to pay, but do we have a system through which they can pay? They can't. We have not designed those systems. Nobody is thinking about it. So that should be the state of the role of, you know, if the center is talking about giving, the state should be looking at how to receive it, which means how to return that money as well. So the recovery systems are so critical. Otherwise, we'll have a totally indebted economy. And this money is not coming, all the money is not coming from our pockets. It's coming from different banks. There's lots of international interest. Nothing wrong with it. Let the money come. But are we smart enough to manage it? That's the question. That's a human resource policy. It is the human resource policy which actually should guide the strategic vision about all the amenities that we provide in cities and how these amenities are networked across the country. Those are the larger, smarter systems that we need to think about, rather than thinking about cities which will consume more money as smart cities.
But what would you do in a government changes, even if you want to recover all those things, the new government comes like what you have in Delhi, where you want to be water-free, power-free, you're supposed to recover as per the earlier commitment of that. So the whole thing goes into chaos.
Well, we don't know as yet because we are not getting them free as yet. So I think when the thing really becomes free, I mean, we are getting more power cuts now than before. We didn't have power cuts before. Now, yesterday, for instance, we hardly had power in the day. It went going and going and going all the time. So there is a breakdown that's happening, and it's already beginning to make itself visible. But if there is any government with a philosophy, it is this one. But they don't have the action plan. The other ones have the action plan, but they have no philosophy. So there is a mismatch any which way. I think we need to address that thing more carefully. Also, if you look at how the Delhi elections reflect the demographic shift that's happened in Delhi, it's the wealthy resettled Punjabi is out of the scene, and we have the immigrant Bihari and the UP Walas voting people, the Aam Aadmi Party to power, and being enshrined as ministers. So we have already seen the signs of that Biharification of Delhi. We can see how fake degrees are floating. Many things are happening. And this is the result of a population shift, demographic shift that's happened in Delhi. And it was Anna Hazare's movement which actually harnessed, mobilized this whole population of immigrants into the electoral arena. And it is that shift that you find playing itself out in the Kejriwal government's politics. So it is much larger than just having free water or free this. It is a totally different kind of agenda. They are making a concerted effort to fulfill their election agenda, which includes regularization of unauthorized colonies, which includes slum rehabilitation, etc., etc. And I have also been party to some other discussions with that group. And I have suggested solely that they should start looking at rental, state-empowered rental housing. Because right now, the assumption is that every migrant is coming here for a house. They're not coming here for a house. They're coming here for some cash. When they get the cash, they go back to the village, they do their cultivation, they do their harvesting, they celebrate their seasons, they get married, and they come back here to make a little more cash. So they want rental, the need is rental housing. And we need to shift the policy from this type of free subsidized delivery of housing, you know, low quality housing because it's low income housing to the poor, from a method which is based on rental housing, state-run rental housing. State should be the facilities manager for those projects. And state should also be able to design systems by which those who want to own houses can have an economic avenue for accessing those houses. We are not designing them. We are taking a shortcut of subsidizing them. You sell the family silver, subsidize the housing. They don't need the subsidy. They can pay. We have not given them an opportunity to pay. That system is not in place. So we need new economic thinking at the ground level, not at the bank level. So that, I think, is the shift that needs to take place between state and this one in some way. There was also one question about the urban village.
Yeah.
Would you like to
go
answer
ahead.
That?
Yeah.
I think I've been talking
Kitty, go
too
ahead.
Much.
Yeah.
If you can please answer that.
Okay. Shravan? 3 minutes.
As far as urban villages are concerned in India, I don't think there is any comprehensive policy or program as such. It has been very ad hoc. Even in Delhi, like I think it has been very, very ad hoc, except for demarcating it as a land, Lal Dora areas and other things. I think what I see, but tremendous potential of urban villages in, like, I have seen some villages in Munirka and in Katwariya Sarai, and professors just talk about the rental housing thing. I think these villages, I have seen one of the most important role they play is providing rental housing. Now, what is very surprising is in the whole housing debate, even in the context of the city, these dimensions are totally lost. So, you know, and interestingly, those villages are developing themselves, you know, like in terms of whether you call it legal or illegal, but the fact of the matter is people are built, people, and there is more need for water, more need for infrastructure, but they also provide tremendous space for people, those who come from outside. So therefore, how do you do it? I think that is totally lacking. And certainly, I think even in the Delhi development plan, there is hardly any mention about, in a detailed way, about the villages in the city. And that is true of all the cities in India. I don't think that is an exception. I just wanted to make a small comment about, you know, the mission mode. Actually, your question, actually, whenever there is a mission mode, that reflects absence of continuity in thinking. Because that is ad hocism. It is reactive mechanism to address a problem which is not there. Therefore, we are always in a mission mode. The last thing about is this whole debate about compact city and, you know, sprawl and all. I think whenever you talk about compact city, the debate is always about land. But the cities don't depend only on land. There are other ecosystem services like water and other resources which the city certainly is much more beyond the land debate. I think we are only focusing on land. The next debate, in fact, land is much more easier issue because you can still acquire. water is drying up. How do we address those issues? I think it is a very narrow way of focusing smart city debate and compact city only on basing on land. And if you see some of the states like Gujarat, let me tell you one thing. Land is also a cultural issue. In states like Gujarat, farmers may still be willing to give up their land, but in many other states like in, you know, West Bengal and others, people will not be willing to give up land. So there are regional and cultural dimensions to that. It's not only about densification and land. There are issues beyond that. I think we have not seen into that context.
I think that will be the last question, please. Thanks.
Thanks. I think that there's some things that are India's really fortunate about. One is that there's not that this doesn't need to be reinventing the wheel in the sense that even though the solutions or the approaches are going to be custom to the, each area, each urban area, there are many parts of the world that have dealt with urbanization. And so there may be models of urban areas or cities to look to of with similar characteristics that might be admired for one thing or another, even though none is perfect. And taking these into account and considering them and identifying them, seeking to identify what has worked for Singapore, what has worked for parts of South Korea, you know, what has worked for maybe Japan or other places that have faced this. Not that this is India, but there may not be a need to reinvent the wheel from scratch. The other is the learning of cities. There's a model I've been privileged to witness and sit in with. I'm Dara Kotavala. I'm from the U.S. visiting Terry as a fellow. My grandfather was the first dairy minister of India, and one of the things he did on behalf of India was to go around to the other countries of the world and see what their buffalo and their cattle were and, you know, what are the values for the milk and so on. Learning communities among cities can really build a lot of capacity. I've seen a model convened by a university, Arizona State University, where the cities get together, the cities in a region get together on a monthly basis, and they have a topic, and they share their experience in approaching this topic. And they try to share sort of what's working and what the challenges are, and they learn iteratively from each other over time. They build trust, they build, you know, capacity in a very safe way. They might also have a guest speaker, or they might have someone invited in for a few meetings that may give a presentation at one of those meetings. And that community peer learning has been very, very potent, very effective over time.
Hall. I must thank both the speakers. I think two key takeaways quite clearly from today's dialogue, the ULB, the local, and not the local in the sense of an opposition from local to national or global to local, but simply the local as being the locus of all of all the transformations that we're talking about, being the testing ground, the test bed, as well as, the, in a sense, the vindication for a lot of the policies. And Shravan brought up, I think, quite emphatically the point about the common man. I think the common man that tends to get forgotten in all of this. And I would definitely like to acknowledge Muni's question about who trains the policymakers and is there a philosophy. I'd like to say that one of the things that we are also being lumped with, as you said, is a capacity building mission. And I think besides the fact that it's a huge challenge, it's really important for us to understand that, like you said, institutional structures need to be built up and new institutions or transformed institutions, not necessarily new numbers of institutions, but transformed institutions are necessary for us to do this. And I think one of the beacons around the world continues to be an NGO that informs or rather dictates the planning of the New York area, the Regional Planning Association. It's an NGO which is mandated and actually dictates the way in which a city like New York grows and manages itself. And the famous Jane Jacobs was a member of the RPA. And there are increasing numbers of such instances around the world. And we have to find similar structures in the Indian context. I think when Shravan was speaking, I was reminded of the writings of a little-known German critic called Siegfried Krakauer, who wrote, or rather, one of his collection of newspaper writings was The Mass Ornament, where he brought up a very compelling argument that unless political ideology actually includes the common man, the common man becomes actually ornament, embellishment for the ideology. And we do need to watch out for that. So with those words, I'd like to close the evening, and thank you very much. Thank you all. Yeah.